Hello everyone, this is Taboo Conspiracy again. This video is intended to prove to the reasonable skeptic that there is no curvature to the Earth. Based on the official numbers, the Earth's alleged curvature should be easily detectable and measurable so that any person with a high zoom camera or a telescope should be able to go out and measure the supposed curvature for themselves. You may laugh, but I actually do have a bachelor's and two master's degrees. I took astronomy and geology in college, and I did get A's. I know the official model pretty well, but I sincerely believe the evidence of the flat Earth far outweighs the evidence of the spinning globe. At the very least, I hope this video will help you to sense that there's a problem with the official heliocentric model, and that you may start to think for yourselves. Flat Earth is just a form of true skepticism. We don't trust our lying governments, their lackeys, and their many hired propagandists who will spam this video. Academic conformity has rendered too many so-called scientists into mere parrots of their progenitors. No one challenges the official story ever, and if you do, you're ostracized. You'd think that true science would welcome challenges to the official model, like those that will be shown in these experiments. Instead, these fake scientists make fun, demand that you conform, appeal to authority, and respond with stupid arguments like dropping microphones or claiming that ships disappear behind the curvature, even though that claim has been proven false in hundreds of real-life examples. In contrast, Flat Earth says, prove all things. It's funny that Flat Earthers seem to be the only true skeptics nowadays. Those who call themselves skeptics are rightfully skeptical of religion, but have failed to hold their fake sciences to the same level of skepticism. Official science demands that you trust them, and to not investigate their underlying fantastic claims, like most fake religions. In contrast, we flat earthers say, don't trust us. Go out and test it for yourself. Research it on your own. Rely on your own intuition. And this is one thing you will never ever hear from the globe propagandists. Go out and measure the alleged curvature yourself. In this video, I'm going to share with you 37 of some of my favorite flat earth experiments, tests, and videos from a variety of flat earthers and even globe believers. But each one of these videos debunks the globe model that you've been programmed to believe in since you were a child. It's time to open your eyes and ask why you were indoctrinated from birth to ridicule and reject flat Earth. Yeah, I know, it sucks to find out there is no Santa Claus and no curvature, and that everything you've been programmed to believe in is a lie, but that's why we're here, to extend to you our flat Earth friendship, because we were all former globe believers at one time, and we all thought that flat Earth was silly. Unfortunately, due to time constraints, I really had to stop adding experiments, and so I have left out a lot of good tests. I just stopped at 37, but there are a lot more. Please don't be offended if I didn't include one of your experiments. But I do ask all of you, flat Earth researchers, to please leave links to your other favorite experiments in the comments below for everyone to see, and I'll try to add them to the description and make a part two to this video as soon as I have another good collection, assuming more than a few people care to watch this long video. But let's get started. We are going to begin with some of my taboo conspiracy experiments as the first four experiments. Yes, that's not very objective to include my own tests, but hey, it's my video, so you can go watch something else or just skip forward to number five. Number one. My sunset mirror test was my first flat earth test, and I'm proud of it. I was not a flat earther at this time, but purchased a Nikon P900, like many others, to see it for myself, because I was incredulous, wondering whether flat earthers were faking their experiments. I conducted this test at Willard Bay, Utah on April 16, 2016. I chose this location because my brother claimed to have seen the curvature at this exact reservoir. For the test, I had my wife, at sunset, take a 4-foot mirror and place it in the water at the opposite end of the reservoir. And I filmed the entire thing from 6.3 miles away with a camera height of 32 inches. The 4-foot mirror should have been entirely hidden below the horizon with a target hidden height of 12 feet. These are the official numbers of how much should be hidden by the curvature. This isn't some fake flat earth math. These numbers have been confirmed by engineering software like AutoCAD as well. You can do the math yourself. It's not 8 inches per mile. It's 8 inches per mile squared. You just need to subtract the alleged globe distance to the horizon first. Sorry, my globe faithful. This is not a mirage.
Okay, we're here. That is my wife carrying a mirror along the beach. It's at 6 miles away. Fortunately, it's very windy right now, so I don't even know if you can hear me well. She is walking straight towards the water level, and she's going to put the mirror right at the water, so you can get a perspective of how far away we are. Was right. 6 miles, no curvature. Should be almost something like 16 feet.
Number two. My next lake test was even better. It was after this test that I began to call myself a flat earther because the explanations offered by the globe zealots were simply asinine. I did not fake this, and anyone can go do this test, and I urge you to. You just need calm and clear conditions without miraging. The test was at Utah Lake on May 13, 2016. I filmed my wife 7.53 miles away carrying a spotlight. My camera was only 2.54 feet above the water. My wife was able to place the spotlight down at the water's edge and it was still visible. In fact, under the globe model, my wife should have been hidden 21 feet below the globe horizon, according to official numbers. You can even see the light from the spotlight hit the camera lens. Do you really think a mirage could do this? Or did I have a direct line of sight to the other shore line in complete contradiction to the globe model? If it was refraction, why isn't the entire area notably distorted?
See, I'm actually touching the water with the tripod, and I'm gonna be looking out that way. Some other people are out here as well, and let's see if we can see her.
Okay, so she's going to break out the spotlight. I hope it is dark enough for us to see her. Do me a favor, turn it off for a second. Perfect. That is you. Okay, turn it on. Okay. Wow. That's... Okay, I'm going to do a zoom out and zoom in. You know, it's actually bright enough. You can almost see it with the naked eye.
Are you sure?
Sure
you got me, right?
Yeah, I mean, you turned it off several times. Oh, there you are. See, I can see you. Oh, I'm zoomed out. Turn it on and off, and I can definitely see you from, you know, without even zooming. How close is it to the water?
I'm at the arm's length.
Okay.
I'm lower down now.
Yeah, turn it on, because I can't see it.
Oh, sorry. It?
Yes.
Okay. On. Next to the water.
Touching the water. Okay. Yeah, you definitely see it.
On.
Can't you see a miracle? The stars are close. Can you make a beach while they circle off the moon? We're not spinning any boat. They're all wrong for this moon.
number 3. After that Utah Lake test, and over the next couple of years, many globe propagandists argued against my video, claiming that the spotlight was visible due to refraction because of the warm air. So, I decided to brave the cold and conduct the same test in freezing conditions when any possible refraction is minimized. This test was on December 9th, 2017. This time, I reversed the locations of my last test, and my wife was able to place the spotlight on the ice. I filmed the whole thing. Again, my wife should have been 21 feet below the horizon line, but there is simply no measurable curvature. None. Zero.
As you can see, not far off of the water. It's actually frozen there. Maybe it's about 32 degrees, maybe 31 degrees outside right now. My wife will have a spotlight that direction at Eagle Park. But this, as you can see, it's standing on the ice right there. There's really no extra inches to be involved here. And the height, about 30 and a half inches. Okay, I'm recording. Over that way is Saratoga Springs. My wife will have a spotlight out there.
Wait a second. Turn it off. I found you. Turn it on. Yeah, you're in between lights. Okay, I found you. Are you out to the water's edge yet?
Yeah, I'm out to the, well, not to the end of the peninsula.
Well, you don't need to go all the way. I see you just until you get to a water's edge. Because, you know, get as much distance as...
You want to be at the water's edge?
Yeah.
Okay.
And all you have to do is now lower it. You're at, where's it at, like, shoulder, chest high, or?
It's on the ice, do you see it?
I just see glowing. But yeah, I can see a reflection in the water sometimes. Shine it on the water a bit.
Is this shining on the ice?
I don't see it.
But it wasn't shining at you.
Now I see a reflection. Okay. Before it dies or anything, can you lower it as far as you can go? Just tell me, just kind of speak out and tell me where it's at.
Okay, do you see it?
Yes.
Okay, do you still see it?
Yes.
Do you still see it?
Yeah.
Do you still see it?
Yeah.
It is on the ice right now. At the edge of the light is on the ice.
Holy crud. All right, that's pretty much flat Earth. I don't see it.
It's on.
Okay, I'm going to keep it on a second. I'm going to zoom out. Be sure to grab your GPS coordinates right where we're doing this.
Okay.
So you have it on the... Yeah, I do.
So I'll turn it off. It's off?
Yep.
It's on.
Okay, I'm going to zoom out again.
I just want to pause it here to point out something. Many of the globe naysayers have claimed and are still going to claim that the spotlight is refracting over the curvature. But notice that the spotlight is exactly between the lights above the spotlight and the reflections on the water. Now, if you're a sincere globe believer, not one of the lying shills who are paid to deceive you, ask yourself this question. How can all of these lights, at varying distances and elevations, including their reflections, all be refracting and hopping over a curvature without losing that flat mirror symmetry? You can see that there is no loss of symmetry here. Nothing is distorted, and the lights are exactly where you'd expect them to be on a flat plane. And that, my friends, belies the stupid refraction argument. Number four. The last test of mine I wanted to include for this video was my horizon test at the Great Salt Lake. Under the globe model, the horizon is a physical barrier for the globe. The horizon marks the point when objects should begin disappearing behind the alleged ground or water. Again, the horizon for the globe model is a physical line. Under the globe model, if you can see the horizon line behind a target object, that means that the target object is not being obscured by any curvature whatsoever. That's a fact. On the other hand, for the flat earther, the horizon is all a matter of perspective. It is a point where the perspective ramping up and the ramping down meet at eye level, which is the horizon line. You can see the evidence of this in a long hallway or tunnel. Interestingly, the horizon is the same point where railroad tracks come together, proving that it is an issue of perspective. But what does the horizon also mean for the globe? It means that no water or the horizon line should ever be visible beyond the mathematically determinable distance to the globe's alleged physical horizon. For example, look at this footage of a distant boat. No objective, reasonable person can claim that this boat is being hidden behind a curvature. Why? Because the horizon line is behind the boat. Remember, under the globe model, the horizon line marks the point when the ground or water mathematically begins obstructing objects supposedly going over the curvature from your point of view. Because the horizon line is behind the boat, then the boat is not being hidden by a curvature. And that's axiomatic. Now, there are several calculators you can use to make the distance to the horizon calculation, including the Metabunk calculator and the Dizzy Bee calculator. In my test, I lowered my camera to just 3 inches above the water, and the horizon should have been only 0.7 miles away, less than 1 mile. Clearly, as shown in the video, the horizon line is miles beyond the mathematically determined globe horizon. That's a big problem for the globe model. I'll show a few more examples of this. I also want you to ponder the globe argument that refraction caused this phenomenon. They claim that we're merely looking at a horizon mirage that has jumped the curvature. It is nonsense, because that would mean that the peninsula wasn't affected by refraction, but the hump of water disappeared in front of the peninsula, and then somehow the water behind the peninsula jumped up to create a new horizon line miles away, all without any visible distortion. I'm actually really sorry for you if you believe in that globe rubbish.
Okay, I'm in the water. A little scary, but as you can see, it's still very visible. Maybe, what, 3 inches above the water? My hand's absolutely in the water right now. I'm gonna pull out my cell phone and show it to you. Oh shoot, my strap's going in. It's gonna be all yucky. Okay. You see, there's the water. It's beyond that point, 1.3 miles away. I'm actually in the water. See, the waves are going past me. Just a few inches, the width of the camera, in the water. You can still see beyond, especially when I zoom in. Okay, so I'm sloppy wet now.
Number 5. Turns out, another flat earther in Italy, who goes by the name Ricerca Independente Terrapiatta, conducted a similar horizon test. In this case, his camera was only 36 centimeters, or 14 inches, high, and the horizon should have been 2.1 kilometers, or 1.3 miles away. Again, the horizon was much further than the globe model allows.
Partire anche. Ecco, adesso sono partiti tutti e due i filmati del mio cellulare, della camera, così possiamo far vedere. Allora,
quasi 36 centimetri praticamente. L'altezza, il centro dell'obiettivo è 36 centimetri, no? Vedete, sotto tocca l'acqua, quindi, perfetto. Vediamo okay. Cosa succede. Vi faccio vedere. Vedete, quella è la punta. Vedete che si vede del mare dietro quell'orizzonte? Vedete che l'orizzonte prosegue. Quella costa che c'è dietro è a, non mi ricordo, 4-5 chilometri. Quella costa che c'è dietro. E questa punta più vicina è a 2.37, mi sembra, no? E, però dove...
Number 6. Our next proof comes from our flat earth friend in Finland with the YouTube channel Sexy, Hot, and Right Shape Flat Earth. He or she is getting some of the clearest long distance shots that I have ever seen. Using marinetraffic.com, our friend was able to track the distance to this boat to the amount of 27 kilometers, or 16.8 miles away from the camera. You can verify the distance by the fact that the large boat in the front is not visible when zoomed out. With an observation height of 0.6 meters or 2 feet, that puts a hidden amount of 151 feet. None of that boat should be visible. What's even more shocking to me is that the horizon should have been only 1.7 miles away. However, as shown here, the horizon is beyond 16.8 miles. Some have disputed this fact, but they are wrong. Look at the boat on the left, much further away. That is an even more distant boat, the bottom of which is perspectively higher than the big boat in front of it, proving that the horizon was even further than 16.8 miles. So, what would the minimum size of the Earth be with a horizon that is 16.8 miles with an observation height of 2 feet? And remember, the horizon is actually significantly further than 16.8 miles. I have the formula here. A radius of 372,557 miles? Come on, people! Either the Earth is nearly the size of the alleged sun, or the Earth is flat.
We're not spinning in the boat. There are wrong for this moon.
Number 7. My good friend Wide Wake is a flat earth superstar. Here's my favorite of his. Wide Wake filmed a bird rack that was only 16 feet high from over 11 miles away. It should have been hidden behind 42 feet. Furthermore, Wide Wake has filmed this many times. This is just one example.
Billy Steel Rack. That's Cutter's Rock. And we're going to get on the other side to see what the sign says. See which bird rack this is. But we are way offshore. It just says Cutter's Rock. Okay, so this is Cutter's Rock.
Whoa. That boat. Yeehaw. See if I can find it.
Number 8. In this next video, Wide Awake got his camera down to a few inches off of the water, meaning the distant bird rack should have been hidden 72 feet below the horizon. Yeah, the bird rack lights are still visible, most certainly defying the gold model. Wide Awake has proven again and again that so long as conditions are clear, the water is calm, there is no mirage, and atmospheric visibility is high, you can see much further than the globe allows again and again.
And not only that, but it's on the lowest setting. I can spider this thing out to where it sets real low. So it's like 2 feet above the water right now. Actually, it's like 21 inches, but I'll give it 2 feet, being that it's not quite all the way in the water.
These three lights are, like I said, the first one there on the left is 3.5 miles. The one in the middle is, 7.5 to 8 miles away. And the one to the right is 11 miles. This is why I say, you need to have the proper lighting. Everything needs to be right. The air is dry. I don't have all that humidity causing the distortion, causing the miraging and the mirroring.
Number 9. Unfortunately, too few people have seen this awesome test by my Australian friend, No Fanfare. Get on No Fanfare's channel and subscribe. I'll try to have all of the links in the description for all of the videos, though. In this video, we're going to take a closer look at the Cassandra ship. I couldn't find the air draft height. That's the part of the boat from the water to the top of the boat. But I did find the extreme breadth. That's from side to side, which is 121 feet. I used a red line to mark it, and then used it as the same marker to determine that the height from the waterline to the red tower is also about 121 feet. Maybe the air draft of the Cassandra is another 20 feet beyond the tower. In all, the Cassandra is about 140 feet from the water to the very top. But in this case, guess how much of the Cassandra should have been visible at 35 miles and an observation height of 158 feet. None of the boat should have been visible with another 120 feet to spare. Does that ship look like a mirage to you? If you were in the Navy, for example, and told to shoot that ship with a missile or a railgun, for example, do you think you'd instead hit a 208 foot tall mountain of water and that the ship is only a mirage? No Navy manual instructs sailors about the mirage ships that are really hidden behind 200 foot walls of curved water. The refraction mirage claim is garbage.
So we'll get the phone on the 4G. We'll get the phone on the 4G and we'll do a Bluetooth tether over to the laptop here. And we'll get on the ship tracker. We'll track ships. Get the pictures of the ships on the ship tracker. And then back over to the P900. Okay, we have the data from the Cassandra in part one. The temperature was 23 degrees Celsius, the humidity was 61%. It was 30.7 nautical miles out, which converts to 35.3 statute miles.
Number 10. Rob Durham was the first to prove that a high-precision mechanical gyroscope does not indicate axial rotation or curvature. The globe supporters claim that these high-precision gyroscopes automatically adjust with gravity is preposterous, as such an argument, if it were true, would render the entire function of the gyroscope in airplanes useless.
And let's start the clock. Okay, that's 15 minutes up. Let's just show that it's still working as it should. Back to zero. So, zero apparent drift at all.
number 11. John Savage was the first who demonstrated that the mechanical gyroscope was sensitive enough to register a 15 degrees per hour rotation by using a 24-hour clock mechanism to slowly rotate the gyroscope. In short, although sensitive enough to detect a 15 degrees rotation per hour, a high-precision modern mechanical gyroscope does not show any indication of axial rotation, contradicting the far-fetched claims of Foucault and his 1800s gyroscope, where Foucault claimed to have measured axial rotation with a gyroscope. So, Foucault's 1800s gyroscope can measure axial rotation, but the high-precision gyroscopes of today cannot? Where are the globe believers calling for a rejection of Foucault's absolutely fake findings? They don't care about the truth, they care about the globe story. F.E. Kaur, Seventh-day Truth Seeker, Paul on the Plane, and others are currently experimenting with IMU devices, and we'll have some awesome tests coming up here shortly. Number 12. This is a great test from Feppe Perth in Australia. Here he films a laser that was 9.56 miles away. The laser should have been hidden 24 feet below the horizon. All you need is a couple $100, a camera, and a friend willing to participate, and you can bust the globe. Do you seriously believe that the laser wrapped around the curvature just to present a false flat Earth? Think about it.
Yes, there, there. To your right, there. To your left, there. And down a tiny bit, down a bit more. Yeah, yeah. There, yeah, there, there. Flash, flash, flash. Let me just check that the camera's getting it. Yeah, camera's getting good flash. Yeah, that's a good one. Oh, that's great. Yeah, that's working really well.
As you saw, the blue laser was easily visible. The conditions down at Heron Point were not ideal. It was windy, it was choppy, and a storm and lightning was forming over in the west. Regardless, we saw the blue laser very clearly. So we had the laser at the tip of the jetty in Port Bouvard, where there is a green channel marker. The nearest landmark is the Port Bouvard Yacht Club. Free Map Tools has this elevation as 1 meter, but we measured it with a tape measure to the water, and it's more like 1.5 meters. We had the laser about 1 meter above the surface, so we estimate the laser height to be approximately 2.5 meters above the water level, as we said, measured with a tape measure. Now, it's a clear shot to Heron Point. There's no obstructions, which is 15.37 kilometers away. The camera was at 0.38 centimeters above the water, measured with a tape measure down to the water surface. So the camera was basically as close as I could get to the water without getting it wet. However, the camera could easily be at 0 centimeters above the water and you would still see the laser fully. If you can see the laser at 0.38 centimeters, you can see it at 0 centimeters. There is no difference at these heights. You can either see the laser or you can't. So at this distance, 13.6 meters through to 18.54 meters of obstruction from the curve of the Earth is missing.
Number 13. The Beyond Horizon website is a treasure trove of Flat Earth proofs, and it's not a Flat Earth website. However, there are dozens of photographs on this website that belie the globe model. There are many others, but this photograph is the record long distance photograph of Pete Gaspard from a whopping 275 miles away. With an observation height of 9,252 feet, the entire mountain with a height of 12,740 feet should have been hidden 16,534 feet below the horizon line, but the globe believers will tell you it's a mirage. Number 14. This next picture from Beyond Horizons is my favorite because it is a picture of the Canigou from Marseille. What makes the Canigou special? First, you shouldn't see the Canigou from Marseille. With an observation height of approximately 1,000 feet, the entire Canigou should be hidden. Second, and more importantly, many people flock to Marseille to watch this bi-yearly event, meaning so long as the sky is clear, onlookers can watch this impossible globe event twice a year at sunset. Think about it. Refraction becomes a ridiculous counter-argument because refraction would have to be on a tight schedule to produce the same impossible photographs twice a year at sunset.
All right, turn that volume down. So what we're looking at is a sunset taking place a couple times a year only because it's when the sun sets in this certain location. So we're going to be fast forwarding a little bit here. Well, you can see it start to happen about right here. So keep your eye on this and you'll see that clearly we are starting to see some peaks behind or in front of the sun. And as the sun progresses further along, you're actually going to see it even better. We'll fast forward a little bit. And this is a known observation. And like I said, there's people that actually go out to look at this. People have taken pictures before. So what are these mountains to the globe heads that believe that things magically lift up due to refraction and get placed in at the end of the horizon? Which I think anybody who just really uses their head and not just listens to what people are told, then they'll know that that doesn't happen, that the light does not bend these things up. So we'll keep watching this. Then we're going to go back over to... So these are the kind of things that, of course, they're not going to be able to answer, so they're just going to have to resort to calling people names, saying that they're stupid, simply because they don't believe what they're told when they do. So you'll see here that peak there is the Canigou Peak, the one we were looking at. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go jump over real quick and look at the... See if I can find it. My browser. Here we go. Okay. So now we're looking here at the Earth Curvature Calculator. I put in 1,000 feet at the eye height, even though I believe they report to be less than 800 feet. Let's put in 1,000 feet for fun. Target distance is 163 miles is the peak of that mountain. Calculate that out and we get 10,296 feet below the horizon. So again, that mountain is 8,500 feet at the very tip top. And so you've almost got 2,000 feet extra that you shouldn't be able to see, let alone any of that mountain. Any of it. Not just, oh, we shouldn't be able to see the tip or why are half the buildings blocked or all the nonsense from the Michigan to Chicago site. This one here is absolutely, completely, and totally impossible in any real world situation.
Number 15. I love this video from Grotto 1 and shared by Globusters because it was one of the best early laser tests. On his snowmobile, Grotto 1 filmed a laser at his feet that was 7.3 miles away at a height of 2.4 feet. That should have been impossible with a curvature drop of approximately 21 feet. Due to this video, the globe supporters have now had to change their story from test the curvature with a laser to the laser also magically follows the curvature due to an unproven globe-removing force called refraction. Even in freezing conditions, the globe supporters will always scream refraction because they have nothing else to help them maintain their globe illusion.
So this is the laser here, just this little black box. and it runs on 12 volts. So I've got it attached to a telescope, which I use as a collimator lens, and I use the telescope to adjust the size of the dot or the beam. And the plan was to try and keep the laser at my back. Occasionally you will see the laser shining on the sled, and sometimes I would lose the laser a little bit, and I found by looking around in the dark I could see where the beam was and then move the sled in line with the laser again. Sometimes I would lose the beam a little bit extra, and I found that by looking back I could always see that little green dot off in the distance and then see where the beam was going from there, and then I would find the beam again and keep going. So right now I can see the laser reflecting off the snow right here. It's so dim, it doesn't light up my hand very much, but it does light up my hand a bit. And the snow here where I'm walking, with ice underneath, is being lit up by the laser. Okay, so this is about 7 or 8 miles. So that's the laser, like 7, 8 miles away.
So once again, 7.5 miles, and now I've dropped the observer height for the laser down to 2.4 feet. And then look what that does at the other end. So there should be 20.93 feet of hidden curvature at the far end. So these illustrations, they're not done to scale, and the angles and such, they're not done correctly. So if you look, for example, if this is 2.4 feet at this end, then comparatively speaking, then this end to scale should actually be higher. I'm not sure, somewhere up higher in there. So also in this illustration now, I've drawn in the ice level here. So I found this very interesting, how I did not have to try and figure out a way to elevate the camera way up high, somewhere in this area, to get a visual on the originating source of the laser way off in the distance. So instead I had the camera way down low here in this area somewhere, and to give you an idea where that is, see, that's actually lower than the level of the laser. So I had that camera sitting about 10 inches above the ice, so that is estimated, it could be a little higher, but the point is I didn't have to climb, you know, a tall tree behind me in the bank somewhere and then try and get a visual on that laser. Like, no, it was like down.
Number 16. No flat earth experiment list is complete without recognizing Samuel Rowbotham's Bedford Canal level experiment. His experiment is a classic because he was the first to detail that you could see much further than should be possible under the globe model. Rowbotham positioned his telescope a few inches above the water and demonstrated that a small boat remained constantly visible for the full 6 miles to Welney Bridge, whereas had the water surface been curved with the accepted circumference of a ball earth, the top of the mast should have been some 11 feet below the line of sight. Many people called Rowbotham a liar. Turns out, Rowbotham was right, as everyone can repeat Rowbotham's tests. Fortunately, now we have high-zoom cameras that record the entire event, which can also be shared online to everyone, something that Rowbotham didn't have access to. My tests at Willard Bay and Utah Lake were 6.3 miles and 7.56 miles respectively, further than Rowbotham's 6 miles. Many other tests have also confirmed that the fact that Rowbotham was right. Zetetic astronomy should be read by everyone, as Rowbotham has a dozen tests that we should all perform with modern equipment. Here's a clip from a video by Seventh-day Truth Seeker.
In Cambridge County, England, there is an artificial canal called the Old Bedford. It is approximately 20 miles in length. Robotham arranged to have a boat with a flag on it that was exactly 5 feet above the surface of the water. The boat was rowed to Welney Bridge, which was exactly 6 statute miles in a straight line from Robotham, who had waded into the water. Robotham stood in the middle of the canal with a telescope exactly 8 inches above the surface of the water. In looking through the eyepiece of the telescope and observing the receding boat during the whole period required to sail to Welney Bridge, quote, "the flag and the boat were distinctly visible throughout the whole distance," close quote. If the earth were round, as it is supposed, the flag should not have been visible to Robotham. The boat and flag should have been 11 feet, 8 inches below the horizon, as depicted in the diagram below. Robotham explains the depiction in the diagram above. Quote, "Let AB represent the arc of water 6 miles long, and AC the line of sight. The point of contact with the arc would be at T, a distance of 1 mile from the observer at A. From T to the bridge at B would be 5 miles, and the curvature from T to B would be 16 feet 8 inches. The top of the flag on the boat, which was 5 feet high, would have been 11 feet 8 inches below the horizon, T, and altogether out of sight. Such a condition was not observed," close quote. Robotham was able to see the flag and boat for the entire 6 mile journey in the canal, all the way to the bridge, as depicted in the diagram below. The fact that Robotham was able to see the flag and boat for the entire 6 miles proves that the earth is flat.
Number 17. These were some great curvature tests conducted by CBS in New Zealand. Turns out that New Zealand also has zero curvature. How about that? Somehow flat earthers continue to always find the flat spots. Soon the globe supporters will be calling the earth a buckyball. Thank you, CBS.
I remember the local legend I'd heard a while back, but dismissed as nonsense. Rumor has it that on a clear day, with everything in the sky just right, you can see all the way to the South Island, and that's much further and much bigger than wee Kapiti Island. So I decided to take a drive around the Wellington coast with my camera and a couple of lenses to test this legend out. I'm going to show each place I drive to in Google Earth and take a few photos so you know it all.
Zooming out and over the South Island. They're a bit further away than I thought. Yeah, that's quite a distance. That's, well, 93 and 81 miles. I had no idea they were that far. Okay, I found this on the web. It's to help measure curvature, and it takes into account the height above sea level that you're measuring from. As you can see, the 12 feet that corresponds to the height on the jetty that I took these photos. Well, so from the Days Bay Wharf, Anakau should be obscured up to 1604 meters, so that only leaves 1,000 meters that we should be seeing, but it seems we can see pretty much all the way down to sea level. That's a whole mile which should be obscured by the horizon. I don't think we're seeing that. Let's go back to those first shots we took at Oviedo Bay, because one of those has got a perfect profile, missing the mountain to the right a little bit, but we should be able to figure out what's what. Check this out, I'll end the video with this. Make up your own mind.
Number 18. Phuket Word's dam footage quickly ended the falsities of the Globe supporters who were claiming that they were taking pictures of the curvature, when they were only taking pictures of miraging and refraction. Yep, those Globe supporters are a bunch of damn liars, and they know it.
So by putting the camera on the ground, we get a similar perspective to that of someone standing on the shore watching a ship go off into the distance across the sea. Keeping in mind that while any surface in nature can be flat, it will always be rugged and never completely smooth like an artificial surface. So first off, we can see this optical phenomenon going on with the railings, which is exactly the same as what is seen in photographs of the causeway and the power lines going across Lake Pontchartrain in the United States. With the claim that this is proof of curvature, when in fact we can see exactly the same thing happening here with these railings. We are below the railings and they appear to bend down towards this band of convergence. The yellow line is the camera's eye level, and the camera's quite level now, so we can see that there is this band of convergence above what appears to be this horizon line of the surface. But this horizontal line is not where the surface begins to curve away from us in any way. It is just as far as we can see from this low perspective before the surface beyond it begins mirroring. This photograph of a fjord taken in cold weather shows the same optical phenomenon happening at the horizon. The purple line shows where the surface actually meets the shore on the other side of the fjord, but then we have this mirroring beneath that and going down to what appears to be the surface of the water. Even with a relatively high perspective above the ground, we soon get this mirroring and convergence. And we'll see as we bring the camera down that the apparent horizon, that hard line of the surface, will come closer to us. The lower we go, the closer the horizon over a flat surface. The surface is still there, sorry about the camera, but it is now mirroring. And as we lift the camera up again, we'll see the mirroring receding and going back posts into the distance. And the railings are now following the laws of perspective. But as we go down, the railings get swallowed up in this band. As this cyclist rides off into the distance across this flat surface, we'll see the same phenomenon that we observe with ships going off into the distance and assumed to be going down a curve, when in fact we can see that his feet and wheels are now disappearing, but he is also being mirrored by the surface. So we have the surface mirroring half of that and the actual rider still on the surface and being observed, even though we cannot see his lower half very clearly. And as he gets further away, there will be this kind of separation of the two, and we are left with just this top half that seems to be floating above this band of convergence or mirroring from the surface. And this, we will see in a moment, is what we actually see at sunset. We see the sun not going down below this apparent horizon of the surface, but we see first this mirroring, and then as it gets further away, it just disappears, just like the cyclist.
Number 19. In my opinion, BMLSB 69 set the modern precedent for flat Earth tests. I recommend that everyone approach these tests methodically, showing camera height and actual distances with coordinates. BMLSB 69 has busted the globe many times. In this video, BMLSB 69 filmed an oil platform 9.41 miles away at an observation height of 1 foot. The platform should have been hidden behind 42 feet of curvature. None of the platform is being obscured. And how do I know that? Because the horizon line is obviously behind the platform. Remember that fact, as it's useful in many videos. I just made a video on the subject, but BMLSB 69's results are even more shocking when you apply the distance to the horizon test. At 1 foot elevation, the horizon should have been only 1.2 miles away. As you can clearly see, the horizon is beyond 9.41 miles, or more than 7.8 times further than the globe model allows. Again, some have contended that it's refraction, but I really want you to think about it. The refraction would have somehow caused the Earth's bulge and the horizon line to disappear in front of the platform and then reappear behind the platforms at approximately 10 times the distance it should have been. Furthermore, refraction performs this miracle without distorting the platforms between these refraction zones. That's some magical refraction, and it's utter nonsense. Number 20. We all remember the lying weatherman who claimed that we were all looking at a Chicago mirage.
Until I found this photo from Grand Mirror State Park. This is from Joshua Nowicki. And what you're seeing here is a mirage. We typically would not be able to see this from the Lake Michigan shore. We talked about this last night. Conditions are right on the lake that we're actually seeing a mirage of the Chicago skyline.
I think most of us investigating the flat Earth had BS alarms go off at that time when we realized that they were lying to us. Good Times for All has taken some amazing photographs and time lapses of the Chicago skyline. These photos are impossible under the globe model. Of course, the globe supporter will claim that it's refraction, but the fact that the time lapse shows no rising of the skyline and no other evidence of distortion proves that refraction was not the cause of these impossible globe photos. Thank you. Number 21. My good friend Sleeping Warrior, aka Anthony Riley, has been out testing the globe many times. He usually spends his time fighting with the globe shields, not my favorite thing to do, but this was my favorite footage from Anthony. Lying on the beach with the camera on the sand, Anthony filmed these land masses 34 miles away that should have been hidden by approximately 700 feet below the horizon. Thanks, Anthony. Number 22. Adam IFE has a lot of great videos, but this one has always been my favorite. Here he filmed a strangely shaped building 21 miles away that should have been entirely hidden below the supposed curvature.
This footage today, and what we've got with I'm going to show you in a minute, not only is going to prove there's no curve, we're going to destroy the globe argument of refraction, where this ridiculous argument where this image is refracted and projected back round the curve to give the impression the Earth is flat, but really it's not, it's a ball. Just nonsense. But we're going to prove that is what it is. Just utter fucking nonsense. Here's the Blacknell Lighthouse here. I'm looking 21 miles. First bridge. Second bridge. Then the tall building at the docks. 20, was it? 21.36 miles, I'm glad at 133. 21 miles, we'll say. All right, we're looking at the channel. It's just absurd, really. Anyway, let's check the footage. All it is, I'm going to be panning out, nothing glamorous. I'm just panning out from that location and showing my location. Panning out. All the way out, all 21 miles away. I'm looking, this is the concrete base I'm stood on, which is what the lighthouse is on. I'm looking down onto the beach, which is probably 8 to 10 feet down there. When the tide comes in, it'll literally come near enough up to the top of that wall. There's the tripod, which is probably 4 feet tall, and here's the Blacknell Lighthouse, okay? And I'm coming down onto the nautical training school, which is just set back. Sorry about that, a bit glitchy there. Bits just set back. But ultimately, I'm right on the beach, yeah? I'm right on the sea. So we're seeing that building from 21 miles away. If we run that through the curve chart, let's see what we come up with. I've given myself a viewer height of 10 feet. Target distance 21 miles. Bearing in mind, let me zoom out and just straighten that. Bearing in mind, I'm stood pretty much at sea level. Although I'm not on the beach, I'm at the base of the lighthouse. I'm viewing something which is pretty much sea level. It's almost ideal. Literally the identical conditions. It's a dock with a building on a concrete foundation base, so they're pretty much the same, but I'm giving myself a viewer height of 10 feet, a little bit extra. We calculate it, and essentially the target should have been hidden. 195 feet should have been hidden. Can you see that there? That building, I was told by the lady at the docks, is 65 meters. That's 195 feet. Essentially, the whole of that building should not have been seen. None of it. And we pretty much can see all of it. There is some miraging, I get that. But we can pretty much see all of it, yeah? Now, what makes this really interesting is when we go to this. We've seen a 21 mile distance. Lovely. Now we're going to do the elevation stats on that to cross-reference. Let me just get that here a minute. I've gone from Black Knorr Lighthouse, this is so telling, to Sharpness Docks, Dock Road, Sharpness, Berkeley. The journey, I'm not really interested in it because it's a walk. It says 28 miles, but that's because I've done it on walk to get the elevation stats. But what really is the giveaway, I've gone up 860 feet. I've come down 860 feet. Notice, flat, plain. Here's the elevation of the journey. I'm looking up the channel. I'm at the lighthouse viewing the dock building. It's showing us sea is fucking level, excuse the swearing. And it's showing the elevation of my journey. But ultimately, the elevation stats are confirming what I'm viewing. That there is no curve, and that I should be seeing that building based on these elevation stats, because these elevation stats are confirming my observations. There is no curve. Yeah, like I said, I went up 860 feet, I came down 860 feet. It's telling me from my point of reference to the building, there's no difference in elevation, and I'm confirms that. Get this nonsense off here.
Number 23. Auguste Piccard was an aeronaut who managed to get 10 miles into the air, higher than commercial flights and about the same height of the cruising altitude of the Concorde. How did Auguste Piccard describe the Earth at 10 miles height? It seemed a flat disk with upturned edge. Number 24. These Russian aeronauts got even higher at 11.8 miles. That's 62,304 feet and more than 2,000 feet higher than the maximum cruising altitude of the Concorde. How did these Russians describe the Earth? Quote, looking down, they tried in vain to detect any curvature of the Earth's horizon. End quote. Number 25. This footage from Felix Baumgartner destroys the globe. Although due to the repeated use of fisheye lenses, I think it was intended to reinforce the globe. Felix allegedly got higher than 128,000 feet. Most importantly, the visibly flat horizon didn't drop one bit, as shown in this video. That shouldn't happen on a globe. The lying globe shields have nothing to counteract this argument. I have to add one more thing about the Felix Baumgartner jump and the other aeronauts and the weather balloons for that matter. Felix proved that the Earth is stationary. It took him 2.5 hours to get to 128,000 feet, and the Earth is supposedly rotating at approximately 1,000 miles per hour below. Felix should have been floating over the Pacific Ocean by the time he jumped. The globe supporters want you to believe that the atmosphere is inexplicably and uniformly Velcroed to the Earth and moves with the Earth like the spokes on a bicycle wheel. That would mean that the Felix's capsule had to speed up to keep up with the ground moving faster below it. Common sense and fluid dynamics tell us otherwise, as the upper atmosphere with no friction should most certainly rotate slower than the ground below it, like a whirlpool, where the outer edges moved much slower than the center. Similarly, volcanic plumes shoot straight up in the air and are not affected by the supposed 1,000-mile-per-hour rotation of the ground below the plume. Yet, globe supporters want you to believe that the rotation of the Earth is proven through an imaginary Coriolis effect and Foucault pendulums. There is simply no evidence that the ground is spinning. I wanted to share with you a quote from Dr. Carl Scheffer, a physics professor. But we know of no body, the parts of which have much less connection with each other than is the case with the air. The air layer next to the Earth, really dragged along by the communicated motion, would not be able to communicate its motion to the layers above it, for the simple reason that it stands in no connection with them. These upper layers must therefore remain in their place, or, which would signify the same thing, would apparently flow westward with the same rapidity with which the Earth is said to rotate to the east. Now, Since a point on the equator, if the Earth rotates on its axis in a day, must move eastward at the rate of 1,250 feet a second, the air would similarly move 1,250 feet westward in a second, which would more than 10 times surpass the velocity of the most fearful hurricane. We cannot perceive the rotation of the Earth in any way. We cannot demonstrate it. There are no air currents which we can justly regard as or even supposed to be, consequences of this rotation. These facts ought to be proof enough against the existence of a rotation of the Earth. Must it not appear almost absurd in us, preoccupied by which they have taught us in school, to accept a theory of the rotation of the Earth which neither is nor can be proven? Must we not wonder at the readiness of the learned of nearly the entire world from the time of Copernicus and Kepler to accept the conception of the rotation of the Earth and then search afterwards, now for nearly 3.5 centuries, for arguments to maintain it, but of course without being able to find them? Dr. Carl Schäffer, The Earth Stands Fast, 1869, physics professor. Number 26. If you can't tell, I like methodical tests a lot. David C. James did it perfectly here as he took these impossible globe photographs of Worm's Head in Wells. Thank you. Number 27. Rob Skiba is one of the most eloquent flat earthers. Kudos to him. He just doesn't talk. He actually goes out and conducts thought-provoking experiments. Rob Skiba had a great test taking a boat out to Chicago, evincing the lensing effect. But for this video, I just wanted to address his home, skyline, and sunset tests.
I went on Amazon and I got these plastic magnifying sheets and came up with another way of doing the same thing. Using the sheet right here, set the city up, a little cutout of the city, and now I've got the big magnifying glass sheet. Bring the camera right up to the lens. See, that's the normal view of the city. Now let's back up again.
The science is the same of that of a lens. Here's a simple example.
So if you're looking at Chicago here,
the atmosphere really is like acting like a lens.
Yes.
Atmosphere really is acting like a lens, and this is how much of the city is missing due to the lensing effect, the magnification of the atmosphere. You're missing, you know, a good portion of the city just by pulling my iPhone back on a 3-foot long desk. That's how much I lost of the city. And as with any scientific experiment, you always try to improve upon what you did before. So I got some foam core, made a little housing for the magnifying sheet, and pasted the city on the back there, and I made it as two separate pieces so that I could flex it as necessary, because I think that there are different types of atmospheric conditions that would allow for more magnification versus less magnification. So in this scenario you have more magnification, and in this one you have less. And for this one I decided to put the Toronto skyline into my little box here. And let's try it again. Okay, we're all the way up against the glass. Now let's zoom across the lake. And wow, look at that. The lower portions start to disappear. Now let's zoom back in to get a little closer to the one that Captain Baltard was talking about here. And wow, look at this. Here's his image on the right, and here's my image on the left. Missing lower portions of the city had nothing to do with curvature whatsoever. And this, of course, is my answer to the meme that you've all seen being passed around on Facebook showing the missing part of buildings is absolute proof of the curve. No, not really. But, okay, here's the part I really wanted to show you guys. I was already in the process of modifying my experiment, so here's what I came up with. I've got my magnifying sheet frame, and I created a little stand to paste the sun on it and keep it the same height over the flat surface of a table, so the sun is always going to be parallel with the surface. And check this out. All right, here's the first test of a sun moving over a flat surface, and with no atmospheric magnification, it does what we might expect it would. It gets smaller as it goes away from us. All right, now let's see what happens when we add in our atmospheric magnification. Again, water and refraction. Water causes magnification and refraction, right? So let's bring the sun back. Oh, check this out. Refraction bends the light downward. It made the sun set on a parallel surface. As it was moving parallel, the same height, the whole way over a flat surface, the refraction caused the sun to set. Not only that, well, let's bring in the beginning of that little test, and we see that it maintained pretty much the same size, too. Pretty close. And, of course, that's because as it's moving away, the magnification is still taking place. And so even though the sun's further away than it was in the beginning of the test, the magnification basically preserved the same size, and the refraction made it set. Now, I'm just going to put forward a crazy idea for you to think about. And that is, if Rob Skiba could figure this out, I'm just going to go out on a limb here. I think it's quite possible that the creator of the cosmos could have figured out the same thing and engineered our beautiful sunsets, thanks to all that water he placed in our atmosphere.
Number 28. DITRH's channel was instrumental in convincing me of the flat earth. He has so many awesome videos. One of my favorite tests of his was his demonstration of how perspective is the cause of the sunsets on a flat earth. Of course, the sun isn't a floating light bulb and is probably intangible, but his test clearly shows how perspective plays a role, while the globe supporter would falsely claim that perspective has no effect on how we see the sun rise and set. Number 29. Good Times for All also conducted a great test in a warehouse and proved that a sunset is possible on a flat earth as he makes the light from the flashlight disappear on a flat surface. What's interesting is that his sunset matches exactly what we see in reality, as I showed with my actual sunset footage.
Alright folks, this is really neat. You gotta check this out. The light is all the way on the ground. As you saw, I laid it down. I'd really like to be able to measure the exact distances and the angles, like precisely, to see when all this stuff starts. Here you'll get the mirroring effect at this distance. It's really neat because when you focus in on just the light, all the stuff in the background goes black, almost like a solar filter. And the objects converge, as you saw. And now here is really cool because it starts setting like a sun almost. The bottom is getting cut off. And it gets more and more. This one was a little out of focus when I snapped it. But as you can see, as I kept going, there was more and more of the bottom was getting cut off until eventually you just don't see the light anymore at all. They keep saying, show me a setting sun. Here you go, on a flat plane. And the light gets even less and less and less to where you barely see anything. And then finally the two mirroring images can converge on each other. And there you go, the sun is set.
The world is closing in. Did you ever think that we could be so close, like brothers? The future's in the air, can feel it everywhere. I'm blowing with the wind of change. Children of tomorrow.
chase flow straight into that phase of time, like a storm wind. Then we ring the freedom bell for peace of mind.
Number 30. The people who launched the little piggy balloon probably weren't flat earthers, but that didn't stop the truth from spreading. What did the little piggy footage at 121,000 feet prove? Well, it proved we've been lied to again and again, because none of us ever saw footage like this until YouTube came around. Our flat earth is beautiful, and little piggy opened my eyes in a big way. Again, it shows that the earth is not spinning at approximately 1,000 miles per hour. I do agree with Jaron from Jaronism in that maybe at a certain altitude it may be possible to see a possible plate Earth rounded at the edges, like rising above a hula hoop, based on just how our vision works. In addition, the sun's light on the Earth would still presumably create a rounded or circular light. Would the roundness of the sun's light on the atmosphere be caught on camera and appear circular? I don't know what that elevation would be. It's all difficult to determine because all camera lenses have a slight distortion. Regardless, I love this footage, but I'm sure you've all seen this many times, so I won't dwell on it. Number 31. I have to also add the dog cam footage. Personally, I think the sun isn't a tangible object, but more like a rainbow that doesn't lose its angular size and is like a projection, maybe even beyond our comprehension. Regardless, this footage is impossible with the sun 93 million miles away, and I don't care how the globe shills spin it. Number 32. I recently shared this messy FN90s test on my channel. There are a few things I love about this test. First, the reflection of the lighthouse is seen on the water when there's supposed to be a curvature drop 177 feet. Second, the lighthouse shouldn't be seen at all, as it should be hidden 152 feet below the horizon. Third, the light obviously hits the camera lens. That means that the refraction excuse supposedly also caused the light from the lighthouse to bend over the curvature to hit the camera. How much proof do you need to let go of your imaginary globe?
San Vito, eccolo qua. Guardate, riflesso lungo, guardate.
This is Houston. Say again, please.
Houston, we have a problem.
I saved number 33 for the U.S. government. Turns out that the U.S. government proved the Earth was flat with a navigational system called LORAN. In short, the U.S. government built radio towers near the ocean that would send out radio signals hundreds of miles across the ocean. Boats could then use the radio waves to triangulate their position. It's a brilliant invention. What's the problem? The bulge of water between the points could be taller than 13 miles, which would most certainly block the radio waves. To counter this argument, the globe supporters would claim that these radio waves hug the curvature over mountains of water several times taller than Everest. Do you believe it? That radio waves wouldn't be blocked by a 13-mile tall bulge of water? Interestingly, LORAN C was specifically developed not to read skywave propagation. Quote, the skywave therefore is generally regarded as a nuisance, and the LORAN C system has been designed in part to minimize the possible influence of skywaves on ground wave reception and tracking. Quote. LORAN C also proves that GPS does not have to come from space satellites. All they had to do was give LORAN C a new name.
Operating 24 hours a day, numerous nations maintain a network of LORAN transmitting stations to service the major shipping lanes. There are a pair here, for example, Siskonset and Bodie Island. One is known as the master station, the other is the slave. For a moment, consider these two stations operating as a synchronous pair, simultaneously emitting short pulses of radio energy. Leaving both shore stations simultaneously, a pair of pulses travel out into space, in all directions, at a constant speed, roughly 186,000 miles per second, or the speed of light. Plus, the pulse from the closer station will reach the ship an instant before the pulse from the other station.
Number 34. Of course, the Skunk Bay time lapse was not a flat Earth video. However, this unequivocally proved atmospheric distortion of the horizon line. The atmosphere can cause distant objects to stretch, to compress, to mirror, and to be obscured by a false horizon line. You can see it all. However, what you don't see are objects arcing over from behind a curvature due to refraction. Unfortunately, dishonest globe propagandists use atmospheric distortion as proof of curvature when it clearly is not. I have repeated this demand on many occasions to the globe faithful. Produce one video of an object geometrically hidden behind a hill, which then arcs over a hill due only to refraction. To date, no globe supporter has produced the arcing over a hill proof, and the flat Earth proofs keep rolling in.
On yonder hill, 'tis there I'd sit and cry my fill until every tear would turn a mill.
Number 35. In this video, Ranty Flat Earth, who has been doing unbelievable work proving the Flat Earth, shows us a shore-to-shore line-of-sight video of distant buildings at a distance of 19 miles, with an observation height of 6 feet and a target hidden height of 171 feet, none of these buildings should be seen, and you can see down to the shore. Furthermore, Ranty takes these videos on a very frequent basis. The claim that magical but unprovable over the curvature refraction is perfect every day is just asinine.
So that wasn't Warmley Lighthouse, this is Warmley Lighthouse here. It's astonishingly clear today. This is Barrow Town Hall, the medical building that's there, etc, etc. Here we have a direct line of sight, shore to shore, of the Barrow buildings, some close to 19 miles away today, off the sun. My elevation above actual sea level right now is approximately 6 feet, and we know that because of this post and the viewings that I've done before next to it. You can see where the horizon is, and you can see that the tide is almost up to that. So from an elevation of 6 feet, close to 19 miles, we are seeing shore to shore.
Number 36. Flat Earth investigators now have a new tool to debunk the globe, infrared, and we are seeing some spectacular Flat Earth results. I do love this video I have playing right now from Jay Tolan Media One. Here, he is filming Las Vegas, 191 miles away at 28,000 feet with an infrared filter. It's obvious that there is no ball arcing downward from this view. The city isn't on some ball bending away with buildings angled away from the camera. The Earth is a flat plane. Be sure to check out his channel. But for this video, we're going to take a closer look at a concrete and repeatable test from FE photographer who filmed an island 19.6 miles away. 141 feet should have been hidden below the horizon, and it appears as though you can see the entire island with a maximum land height of 95 feet.
In this regular photo, you're able to see a lot of Clark Island, and you can see the green buoy channel marker on the left-hand side as well. And in this infrared photo from the same location, you're able to see better detail in the trees and the island itself. So infrared definitely makes a difference when it comes to showing detail when we compare these two images as seen here. Now, using an Earth curve calculator with an observer height of 17 feet and a target distance of 19.59 miles, we get a hidden target height of 141 feet. Now, as I stated before, the island has a maximum land height of 95 feet per Wikipedia, plus a maximum tree height of approximately 100 feet, and this is being generous for a tree height in the islands. So if we go worst-case scenario, the island is approximately 195 feet tall at its highest point. If you look at the hidden target minus the maximum height of the island, including the trees, there would only be 55 feet of treetops that you would be seeing above the horizon as shown in my example here. Yet you can make out all the different types and shapes of trees and even what appears to be a rocky, dark coastline of the island. Now let's take a look at Clark Island from Orcas Island looking west, and you'll notice the lower portion of the island between north and middle and how they compare to the infrared picture, and also notice the dark-edged coastline. To me, this is clear evidence that there is no curve. The infrared image clearly shows the shape of the island, individual tree shapes and sizes, and even a rocky coastline. At a distance of 19.59 miles between the two locations, the globe map tells us 141 feet of the island should be hidden from view, but it's not from what I can determine. As many others will say, including myself, don't take my word for it. Go test it and see what you can come up with. It's only through personal observation and testing that we can truly start to see the world around us.
Finally, number 37. I saved one of the best tests for last. FE Core is setting the new standard for flat Earth testing, but they are not taking away everyone's responsibility to test the Earth themselves. Although FE Core has many tests planned, on April 22, 2018, FE Core achieved witnessing a laser 25 miles across a body of water. A whopping 298 feet should have been hidden below the horizon, meaning that the laser should have only been visible on top of a building like this, the Central Tower in San Francisco. However, FE Core didn't need to climb up a skyscraper 298 feet tall to see the laser. They observed the laser at only 5 feet above the water. The alleged curvature of the Earth simply doesn't exist. Importantly, FE Core took all of the refraction measurements, and as suspected, the refraction correction was negligible. What's the globe zealot excuse now? Gravity? FE Core has an upcoming microwave test that will be awesome as well. Visit their website, subscribe, and join as the equipment costs a lot and we could use a lot more voices there. That's the end of my video. I apologize to all of the many great flat earthers and their tests I failed to mention. I had to stop somewhere. In actuality, this video was meant to be a top 10, but I couldn't stop. Again, please share all of your best testing videos in the comments. I'll keep checking the spam filter over the next couple weeks. I want to make sure that everyone has a chance to see your flat earth experiments, and I'll try to make a part 2 to this video if anyone cares. Also, if at any time you have a small channel and have conducted a great flat earth test, please let me know, and I'll try to share it and advertise your channel as well. I don't have too many subscribers, but I love to help others spread the word. Although I support organized groups like FE Core, I primarily support the grassroots experiments of the Flat Earth, which makes this so awesome. Together, we're busting the globe. Please, no more leader worship, as leaders can lead you astray. As always, you're welcome to copy, share, edit, or do whatever you want with this video. I just plagiarized a bunch of other people anyways. I'm going to close with Amber Plaster's beautiful Flat Earth song that really touched my heart, and it still gets to me. May the Lord bless you all with knowledge, love, kindness, charity, and an unquenchable desire to know and share His truth, whatever it may be. Thank you.
Hello, it's me. You know, indoctrination started while we were still naive. Program me our beliefs. That inertia is the reason we don't feel the earth spinning. Hello, can you hear me? Did you ever stop to question the confession of gravity as a theory? Funny thing, force alone can be explained with buoyancy and density. The sun is closer than what they've told us, not 90 million miles away. Flat Earth and Globe discussion group to discuss.